Hello, Lakers Nation. Welcome in. Trevor Lane here for LakersNation.com, your home for everything Lakers. And what I want to do today is break down the standings, where the Lakers currently sit, what needs to happen from here on out. 7 games left in the season. Take a look at the tiebreakers, the schedule for the Lakers, as well as the schedule for their opponents. So we all know exactly what the Lakers are staring down heading into this home stretch and what they need to do in order to, number one, make the play-in, but also ideally move up in the standing. So I was talking about this a little bit earlier on Twitter, and I will reference a tweet that I put out with the schedule breakdown and all of that. But first, let's just take a look at the standings themselves. Right now, the Lakers sitting in the 9 seed. You see them technically in a tie with the Oklahoma City Thunder, but the Lakers do have that tiebreaker over OKC. New Orleans has won 5 in a row. That hurt. The Pelicans winning 5 in a row has not been ideal, but they do take on the Golden State Warriors tonight. You can argue whether you prefer to see the Warriors lose that game or the Pelicans lose that game. Either team, I think, would be beneficial for the Lakers if they were to lose. Too bad there isn't a way for both those teams to lose. But you look at what Minnesota's doing. They've won 4 in a row, including some games that they were not favored to win. So, look, credit to the Wolves, but this has been extremely unfortunate for the Lakers that the Wolves have been rattling off these wins, including games that you looked at and on paper you said, okay, the Wolves probably should lose this one. They have found ways to win these games. Again, credit to them. Credit to their coaching. They've been a good team. But it's been unfortunate for the Lakers. And I think what it effectively means is it's unlikely that we see the Lakers move up to 6, particularly because the Wolves do have the tiebreaker over the Lakers. So I know it's only a game and a half. And if you're able to beat the Wolves on Friday, yeah, it probably puts that in play. But I wouldn't say it's likely. Moving up to the 6th seed, it looks like it's becoming less and less likely as the Wolves continue to win games. Could the Clippers lose out some games, particularly without Paul George? Potentially, but again, there's a 2.5 game gap there, and with only 7 games to play, that's going to be kind of difficult there. And then you look at the play-in race here. The Lakers do have the tiebreaker over Golden State, the tiebreaker over the Pelicans, the tiebreaker over the Thunder. All those things help. So ideally, what you want to see is the Lakers remaining in direct competition with those teams. What you don't really want to see is the Dallas Mavericks putting themselves back into the mix. And I would anticipate that the Mavs will put themselves back in the mix. But the Lakers do not own the tiebreaker over the Dallas Mavericks. So that's something to keep an eye on. If you're competing against the Warriors, the Pelicans, the Thunder, you're in better shape than if you're competing against the Mavericks. Again, right now in the loss column, the Lakers 1 back of the Pelicans and the Warriors. And they are 1 game up in the loss column on the Mavericks. So something to keep an eye on there in terms of the tiebreaker situation and where the Lakers are currently at in the standings. Remember, before I get into the schedule, it actually makes a huge difference if you are the 7 or 8 seed or the 9 or 10 seed. The way the play-in tournament works is the 7 and 8 seed would play each other in round 1 of the tournament. The winner becomes the 7 seed. The loser plays the winner of the 9 versus 10 matchup. The winner of the 9 versus 10 matchup goes to round 2 and plays the loser of 7 versus 8. The loser of 9 versus 10 goes home. So effectively, the way to look at this is if you're the 7 seed or the 8 seed, then you are in a double elimination situation. You have 2 opportunities to win 1 game to get into the postseason. That's if you're the 7 or the 8 seed. If you are the 9 or the 10 seed, it is single elimination and you have to win 2 games in a row. You have 2 opportunities. You have to win both games in order to advance if you're 9 or 10. So it's actually a really big difference between being 7 or 8 and 9 or 10. You definitely do not want to be 9 or 10 in this situation. And that is where the Lakers currently sit. Unfortunately, no games left on the schedule either against the Pelicans or the Warriors. So Lakers are going to need those teams to drop some games for them here. But that's what the Lakers are staring down in the play-in tournament. And the 7 seed, the 9 seed, they get home court advantage in round 1. Of course, in round 2, the 7 or 8, whichever team lost, will get home court advantage in the 2nd round. So if you're the 10 seed, you have to win 2 games on the road. If you're the 9 seed, you have to win 1 game at home, 1 game on the road in order to get through. Not easy to do in either case. So you definitely want to try to make that move up to at least 7 or 8 if you're the Lakers. If there is an opportunity to do it, let's say you beat Minnesota on Friday and you can somehow get up to 6, all the better. Then you don't even have to worry about the play-in. You get an extra week or so to kind of rest up before the playoffs start, and off you go. So that's certainly ideal, but more realistic, try to make that push for the 7 or 8. All right, let's look at the schedules. Here's what the Lakers have ahead of them. The Lakers have Chicago, Minnesota, Houston, Utah, the Clippers, Phoenix, Utah. Not the easiest schedule. The Jazz have definitely dropped off. Going back to the standings real quick, Utah is now sitting two games behind the Lakers. They've had some injury issues. They've lost four in a row. I think they're about ready to call it on the season. Now, does that mean they're not going to go all out against the Lakers? No, I'm expecting they will. That tends to be what happens. Teams really go after the Lakers. And remember, they have several former Lakers on that roster that are going to be extra motivated to compete against LA. But nonetheless, two games against Utah in there, those are going to be pivotal. So you play Utah twice in your final seven games. Chicago, you really need to get a win here on Wednesday. You put yourself in this situation by losing the previous game to the Bulls. You lost at home. Now you've got to go into Chicago and get a win there. Vucevic, who only played, I think, 15 minutes because he got thrown out of the game, should be in action. The Lakers' bigs will be under pressure, given the fact that Andre Drummond matching up with Wenyen Gabriel. He's like twice Wenyen Gabriel's size. That's going to be something to keep an eye on. But the Lakers need to figure out a way to get a win in that one, because then you go to Minnesota. And Minnesota is, again, red hot on the road. You go there. They've been playing fantastic basketball. And frankly, that team is built to beat the Lakers. You look at the way that team is put together. You look at the wing depth that they've got. They're the type of team that tends to give the Lakers trouble. So that's not going to be an easy one. Again, puts even more pressure on you to win that Chicago game. Of course, you cannot lose to Houston. My goodness, Lakers, we can't go down that path again. Then you get Utah again. The Clippers, wouldn't it be great to beat the Clippers? The Clippers without Paul George. Hopefully the Lakers will be healthy. But remember, that is a back-to-back there with Utah and the Clippers. So does LeBron play in back-to-backs? Does Anthony Davis play in back-to-backs? What does that look like? And we're actually getting into a point where the Clippers are looking pretty solidified in their playoff seating. So if I'm the Lakers and I have to sit LeBron and AD, I might be playing them in Utah and sitting them against the Clippers, knowing that Utah is a team that if you're giving your 100%, if you've got your full team, you should win. Stack that win on your record. And then if you have to lose either one of those games, the Clippers game would probably be the preferable one to lose, because I don't think you're going to catch that team anyway. Phoenix, Kevin Durant should be back. Won't be an easy matchup. It depends, though. Sometimes things get weird at the end of the season because teams start to rest players. I mean, look, we just saw it last night. The Pelicans took on the Blazers and blew them out because the Blazers went, well, season's over, and they sat everybody. All their guys, Jeremy Grant, Anthony Simons, Damian Lillard, just said, nope, we're done. So it turned into a blowout win. So you never know. If Phoenix is set with their playoff positioning, if they're locked into a spot, maybe they don't play everybody for that game. But something to keep an eye on. And then you finish off the season with Utah. So looking at opportunities to move up with these schedules. Again, the Clippers, I don't think you're catching, although they do have somewhat of a difficult schedule. You've got Memphis twice. Those aren't easy games. The Pelicans, the Lakers actually need the Clippers to win that game against the Pelicans. Then they get the Lakers. But then Portland and Phoenix for the final game of the season. Have to imagine Phoenix by then will definitely be shutting people down. The Clippers will probably be shutting people down for the final game of the season as well. So it's hard to say how that one's going to go. Portland is essentially a gimme win at this point because they're not playing any of their starters. So the Clippers have a tough stretch here of a few games. But again, I wouldn't anticipate, unless the Lakers go on a crazy run, that you can catch them. Minnesota, not easy necessarily when you look at Phoenix and then the Lakers, but Portland, that's again turned into essentially a gimme. Brooklyn, San Antonio's a gimme. And then they finish off the season against the Pelicans, which I'm hoping that final game of the season, Minnesota is not locked into a playoff spot and has to compete, because that game could end up mattering. That game could end up mattering either for the Pelicans or for the Wolves, or it could matter for both. And it could matter big time for the Lakers too. Remember, there's also the added drama of the pick swap situation with the Lakers and the Pelicans, where if the Pelicans finish ahead of the Lakers, then likely they will swap picks, though they're so close in the standings, it's probably not going to be a big deal unless the team gets into the lottery and somehow it probably jumps up. But keep an eye on that final game of the season for Minnesota. You look at Golden State, again, not they've got some very winnable games here. Finish off the season with Portland, again, that should be a gimme. And then they've got San Antonio, another gimme. But the Warriors and Pelicans, that's going to be an intriguing matchup. They've got to figure out, we've got to figure out who the preferred option is there. I actually think the Pelicans have a very difficult schedule down the stretch. So I actually think I'm rooting for New Orleans to win the game against the Warriors, try to knock the Warriors down a little bit more, and then trust that New Orleans is going to drop some of their other games here coming up and hopefully help the Lakers surge ahead. Looking at New Orleans, Golden State, Denver, Clippers, Sacramento, Memphis, New York, Minnesota. Wow, that's brutal. Look, Trey Murphy III has games every now and then where he goes berserk and will hit a bunch of threes and put up 30 points and the Pelicans win. But aside from that happening or Zion returning, ideally the Pelicans will drop a lot of these games. Ideally you drop five of these, right? I mean, that's what you're hoping if you're the Lakers. Five of those seven, the Pelicans drop. I mean, I don't think they'll be the favorite in many of those games. So hopefully you don't see the Pelicans have been playing great, but hopefully this, and they've had a very light schedule lately, hopefully this stretch puts an end to the Pelicans' surge. If it doesn't, if you start to see the Pelicans rack up some wins that you're not expecting them to get, like if you see the Pelicans beat the Nuggets, you see the Pelicans beat two of the Clippers, Kings, and Grizzlies, like if they win two of those three, then you can start getting nervous there with the Pelicans. But again, they have, I think, the most difficult schedule from here. OKC, super light. This is why after the Lakers beat the Thunder and the Lakers went ahead of them in the standings, I said, you know what? You can't pass a team in the West right now and just assume they're in the rear view. I had a lot of Lakers fans that were kind of, they were assuming that to be the case. Okay, we've passed the Thunder. Who do we go after next? Who can we go after? We don't need to worry about the Thunder losing. Not the case. Not the case. They have a super light schedule from here on out. Look at this. Charlotte, Detroit, Indiana. Indiana just sat Tyrese Halliburton against Dallas last night. If they start doing that, Indiana is a much worse team without Halliburton in there. Phoenix, okay, that's a tough one. Warriors, that's a tough one. Then Utah, Memphis for the final game of the season. But who knows who Memphis is going to actually be playing in that last game of the season. So you look at that, there's probably two games there that the Thunder should lose, and that's the Suns and the Warriors, and that's about it. I mean, you could very easily see the Thunder winning every other game left on their schedule aside from those two. So they are very much a team to still be worried about. Again, the Lakers have the tiebreaker over them, so that does help. Dallas, again, they are half a game back right now, one game back in the loss column to the Lakers. Philly, hopefully the Dallas Mavericks lose that one. Miami, Atlanta, ideally they lose at least one of those two, hopefully losing to Sacramento. Then they get Chicago, San Antonio. So San Antonio, that's, again, the gimme win to finish off the season. But the Mavs, the Lakers need them to continue losing games. If they get some upset wins here, and remember, the Mavs are a high-volume three-point shooting team. If they get hot from three, they can beat anybody on any given night. So I don't look at any game and say, oh, that's a definite loss for Dallas. But if they can rattle off some losses here, particularly in this four-game stretch, Philly, Miami, Atlanta, Sacramento, best case, if they lose three of those four, that would go a long way towards helping the Lakers out. Because once again, Lakers have the tiebreaker over the Warriors, the Pelicans, OKC, do not have tiebreakers against the Clippers in Minnesota, which is part of why it's going to be that much harder to move up to six, and do not have the tiebreaker over Dallas. So what you don't want to see is Dallas getting back into the mix, winning their way back in to that 7-10 battle, because what we're looking at right now is Warriors, Pelicans, Lakers, Thunder, Mavs. One of those teams will not make it. So if you're the Lakers, what you want to see is the Dallas Mavericks continue to sit out on the outside looking in. And then at the very least, you have the tiebreaker over those other three teams that you are competing with. So again, the Lakers schedule, what do they need to do? Chicago, Minnesota, Houston. Well, let's say the games they'd be favored in are going to be Houston and both games against Utah. Those are must wins. So you got to win those two, or those three. So let's say those are three wins out of seven right there. Chicago, Minnesota, Clippers, Phoenix. I think you need to go 500. In those games. Go 500 and you'd be feeling pretty good there in those games. So that would mean in the final seven, you go 5-2. If you go 5-2, you're probably moving up in the standings and feeling pretty good about the Lakers heading in. I think the minimum, you need to at least go 4-3. And that would mean you win in, you win against Houston, you win against Utah both times, and then you win one of Chicago, Minnesota, the Clippers, and Phoenix. Again, I think you can be optimistic that they can do better than that. I also will say, don't completely write off Utah. Don't completely write off Houston, because you just never know in the NBA. Anybody can get hot on any given night. Look, the Hornets beat the Mavs twice. Like, you would never have predicted that to happen, particularly in the situation the Mavs are in. And yet it happened. You just never know. So you can't start chalking those up as wins just yet, but those will be games the Lakers should be favored in. So I'm looking for the Lakers to, at the minimum, go 4-3 over the final stretch. Probably best case we can hope for, 5-2. If they do that, you'd be feeling pretty good heading into the play-in, especially looking at where everybody else is at in the standings and the tiebreakers that the Lakers do have. All right, so that was my long-winded segment on where things currently sit with the Lakers, where things are with the standings right now, what they need to do moving forward. Again, I've got a lot of people that are doom and gloom at the moment saying, oh my gosh, the season is over, the sky is falling after that loss to the Chicago Bulls. If you look at the last four games, the Lakers are 3-1 in their last four. Again, things have looked better. You got LeBron back. So yeah, the last loss is certainly frustrating, but I still think the Lakers are in position to make a postseason push. Got to win games. You have to take care of business, but all is not lost, Lakers Nation. All is not lost. But give me your thoughts in the comments down below. Looking at the schedule, looking at the standings, what are you expecting to see from here on out? Till next time, everybody. See ya and stay safe.